after every morning's exercise, I go outside to get some fresh air. Usually I end up being here like an hour or so. Depending on the day, either I've done a snowman, or I've gone to the slide, or just for a walk, because it's extremely pretty here. I'm all the way up here. It's gonna be only one time thing, because getting up here was quite an exercise, because the snow doesn't carry you, so I couldn't simply walk up here as I was coming up here on all my fours. There we are, all the way up here. It looked ridiculous, and I saw one person. They're like, is she okay? The phone here. All right. Oh my gosh. I think we just need to go and think about it. Okay, this is definitely not working the way I wanted it to. This is. Literally doesn't carry you, and me screaming definitely will attract everyone's attention. I see some. This is the beginning of day 5 in isolation. I am used to being alone. It's not like, oh, poor her. It is a choice. But the reason why I usually do that is because in my job, it requires me to be extremely social on a daily basis with like hundreds of people. It is too blue draining. I think this is getting better anyway, but I think it's just, I don't know. Not kidding. So having that time in the evening all on my own is more than needed. The place I live in England, I don't live alone there. I do have flatmates. I live in the top floor alone, so it does kind of feel like I'm on my own, because I can't hear that much of anyone else. But you just feel the presence of everyone in the house, so you know that you're not on your own. I haven't actually lived entirely alone for 11 years now. And I lived in Vasa, which was like one of the nearest cities from my hometown. It was on the west coast of Finland. It was like you used to, as if the city was there and it just disappeared after I left. It still is very much of a city in Finland, on the west coast, where like about 50%, maybe I'm lying, but a lot of people are Swedish or Finnish. Swedish can't get a job unless you speak a little bit Swedish, and my Swedish has been rubbish my entire life, so it was interesting times. Anyway, so I lived alone in there after I had just broke up with my boyfriend back then, but I didn't want to move back home. I do remember from living there that evenings and night times were extremely difficult. I have been overly sensitive my entire life, but I love horror films. I think it was like 15 or something when I saw The Grudge. I saw the American version first, as most of us probably did. I couldn't sleep for like whole 2 months after that properly. The impact that the film had on me was just so strong. Like I had black hair back then, and I hated my naturally curly hair, so I kept straightening it all the time. Like, you know when it gets dark outside, and if you have lights inside, you see the reflection of yourself, and the window, I would just go crazy because obviously I saw myself with black hair, but black straight hair, quite pale skin, because it's crazy stuff like that. But all these supernatural things would get me like that, and it's crazy. I am a pagan myself as well, so it's not like all the supernatural things are happening just in films, which I find very fascinating, but at the same time, it does play tricks with your mind if you're as sensitive as I am. I am 29 years old, I'm gonna be 30 in 7 days, and I'm still scared of dark. I'm not scared of dark itself, I'm just scared what my brain can form of the little things in dark. I mean, all the humans have this, that their brain are forming or trying to form like rational things of the things that they see in the dark. But mine does it, I think, a bit overactively, let's say. I have been in this cabin for 5 days now, and during the day it's fine. It is a bit quiet. I haven't used it as silence. I've been living in London the past month, and coming here has been very weird. It's lovely. I love winter. I love the amount of light, and I do love the peace and quiet, the absolute silence. And I love that I can actually go and have a walk without bumping into absolutely anyone, so it's a perfect quarantine place. But every time it gets dark outside, and it does get quite early, like nighttime is the most difficult when I have to switch off everything. I have to switch off all the lights and all the devices, and then I go to my bedroom, and it's just so silent, and it freaks me out. And what is worse, that because it's so silent, you can hear everything. You know, this is a wooden cabin, and obviously wooden houses, they do live according to the weather. So when it has been extremely cold and it starts to get warmer, the wood kind of makes these sounds because it's that all of these little noises. I'm like, what was that? What was that? And last night there was this weird banging sound. Not only that noise, but I just felt like I genuinely felt that there was a presence in the same cabin with me. And I was in bed, so I was like, I genuinely felt that like silence taking over me. And then I felt this presence, and I was like, I got goosebumps all over. I was like, oh my gosh, this is happening. I'm in the middle of nowhere. Like, even if I called someone, no one would make it here like early enough. And I just couldn't sleep, so I was like, okay, I need to go. When it gets dark here, it gets really dark. If I switch off all the lights, it is really dark. There isn't any street lamp gloom coming inside. It is pitch black. I'm still so tired and exhausted because I've been spending my night like that. Coffee. What I've been doing now is that I go to bed at midnight. I mean, this is Finnish time, and I feel like my body is still in the UK time. A week before that, it was in Spanish time, and that's like also fucked up. It's not like there's a massive time difference, it's literally just about a couple of hours. So I would go to bed at midnight, and I would wake up around 9, which is the most I've ever slept in my life. I don't usually sleep more than, well, 7.5 hours is ideal because, sorry, that means that I get to complete my sleep cycles. Anything below that lowers at least my immune system and does not make me feel good at all. Anything more than that just gives me a headache and does not keep me productive as I would like to be. As my sister called me on the other day, was tohinatäti, which is basically a person who, like, is whooshing around because she wants to do so much. I look very weird when I don't wear any makeup and I've just woken up. I'm gonna dye my hair today. I am not one of those people who would dye their hair often with like shock colors, simply for that reason that I'm still trying to break into the industry and I'm trying to keep it consistent and
Fairly, well, natural, because if I had like extreme colors in my hair, it would definitely limit my the roles that I could undertake. So I've gone through as a ginger for 5 years now, I think. I had black hair for a long, long time. It fades away even quicker with my hair because I have developed an allergy to PPD and other chemicals found in chemical hair dyes, and I found out about it last summer only. So I'm gonna dye my hair blue. I did find a blue hair color from the train station. There was a like this hair salon. Typical Finland, there was a hair salon in the train station because everyone dyes their hair. It's one of these like it's not like chemical hair dye, it's one of these that you apply on and it will last for like a couple of washes. I'm not expecting to leave this bathroom with like amazing blue sapphire sky hair. I always said to myself, jokingly, that if I will make it as an actor, I will dye my hair blue, I will get all the piercings that I ever wanted, I will be the most beautiful goth. So that would literally mean like I have the freedom to dress however I want, because as an actor, maybe, I mean, I think some people don't care about the fact that you're an actor and they don't let it stand in your way. They do it anyway. I want to be casted into certain types of roles for which blue hair does not go together to. But anyway, so there's plenty of time to mess up with my hair. And then trying to recover it back to ginger by the time we're all good to go. The good thing is that in our musicals, mainly, we are using wigs. Okay. So I've done, obviously, with like I do with every hair color, even if they didn't contain any of the chemicals that I'm allergic to, I do a patch test. I did not use to do patch tests when I was dyeing my hair with chemical hair dyes, which is ridiculous. The reaction that I got from it last year, it is extremely dangerous. You need to do a patch test. I do even with those colours, even the one that I use in England, it's like that is like organic hair colour. Well, it looks like a bruise now. But I did a patch test there 4 days ago, and then another one behind my ear 2 days ago. Contrast is really big. Like I've always, and now as well, it's been very warm color. It's gonna be so cold, but it's just because like if I didn't do it now, when the fuck will I do it?
You better work!
Every single video of my vlog, I haven't worn much of makeup. I've always been in rehearsals, out of rehearsals, or I've just been on the quarantine. So I haven't been bothered to make myself look nice because natural beauty and all that. I mean, I haven't changed this just because I dyed my hair. It was literally because I wanted to go outside to take some pictures with my new hair because I can't keep up this for a long time. This was the only chance that I could actually do something different with my hair because there won't be any work in the near future. I am gonna continue a bit later because I am gonna go and watch the final episode of Key Lock or Lock Key from Netflix with my friend Johanna because we're both in Finland now. She's in Helsinki. And I'm in Lapland, and we're gonna Netflix share and watch that final episode because we've been watching that show together. When I was rehearsing in London, I was staying at her place,
And this is the final episode, and it's so scary to watch alone, especially when you're in the middle of nowhere, but we're gonna do it.